All right, guys, let's start the concept of moratorium. Very, very important. Yes, section 14 is moratorium. Extremely important section in the context of the examination. Why? Because there have been quite a few changes. So quickly, what is moratorium? Very, very simple. So whenever a financial creditor, operational creditor or a corporate debtor applies to the NCLT, and NCLT admits the application, then we know that the CIRP begins, that is the corporate insolvency resolution process. If other laws under Companies Act, then your SURFACE, then your RDDBFI, under Contract Act, Civil Court judgments, everything come here and simply disturb the company, that will not, you know, that will actually hamper the entire resolution process. That's the reason why. What do we have? We have the concept of statute, where the NCLT says, boss, temporary suspension of all the cases. So that statute which they impose immediately upon the admission and the public announcement, that is called as moratorium, temporary suspension of activity. Activity means what activity is what we need to see. So moratorium begins. The moratorium will go till the process of CIRP, full process. That would be how many days? 180 plus 90 days. In this 180 plus 90 days, in this benefit given by the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, what will happen to them? They will arm say now, see how to do business. They will obviously form the COC. IRP anyway will be appointed. Then RP will appoint. He will now open up the entire company where others can come and take over. So you get EOI, expression of interest. Expression of interest will be given by people called as RA, resolution applicant, right? All that we have studied, guys. I'm just quickly revising so that we can start the concept. And then what happens? Resolution plan will be submitted to whom? Resolution plan will be submitted to the COC. COC will say, okay, fine, this is fine, and the 66% majority, they will pass the resolution and it will go to the NCLT. NCLT will eventually say, okay, fine, this is good, we can go ahead with it, issue settled, resolution plan will be approved. This is the scene. But I have to be protected by a mechanism, and that mechanism, friends, is called as moratorium, where outside things will not come into the picture. I am not burdened by outside the suits, arbitration and all those things. Now the biggest question is, will the activities go on? Correct? That is one question. Second, will it impact the assets of the company? Assets of the company means what? Assets lying in the company, or assets belonging to the company, or assets lying elsewhere in some warehouse but belonging to the company. So many things I have to see, right? And what are the amendments that have come? Can a high court judgment overthrow this moratorium? I have a friend, we go to cult together. I'm a member of this cult, which anyway got closed down now till this thing, Corona. So his dad is a very, very famous lawyer in Bangalore. So he's also a lawyer. So he was telling that his father fought a case where they challenged the constitutionality of the moratorium. They said, how the hell can you stop other laws from, you know, coming into force, or other laws? So basically he won the case also in one judgment. Correct. So the thing is, they said it is unconstitutional moratorium. So like that, various cases are going on. We need to understand what it will bar, what it will not bar. Let us see now. Right, section 14. Subject to the provisions of subsection 2 and 3. Subject to the provisions of subsection 2 and 3. On the insolvency commencement date, what is the insolvency commencement date? The date the NCLT accepts the application, admits the application. The day you apply, 14 days time is given to them to admit or reject. We have already seen that. When the moment they admit, what should they do? We saw now, IRP they will appoint. And that is the day when they admit the applicant, that is the day when moratorium also begins. The adjudicating authority shall by an order declare moratorium, shall by an order declare moratorium, already discussed guys. By an order do what? Declare moratorium, this part we have discussed now already before the break. That's okay, moving on. For prohibiting all of the following, namely institution of suits or continuation of pending suits, means what? Can new cases be filed against the company? No. Can existing cases continue? Can existing cases continue also? Answer is no. Correct? Can existing cases continue? Answer is no. Or proceedings against the corporate debtor, including execution of any judgment, decree, again is an order, or order in any court of law, tribunal, arbitration panel or other authority. Law, tribunal, arbitration panel or any other authority. What about income tax case? ITAT, then your GSTAT, all those things. Other authority means comes all those things, quasi judicial body. Law, court of law, civil court, criminal court, whatever, criminal court will see, civil court, tribunal. Tribunal is anyway there, no, NCLT, ITAT, correct, GSTAT. Arbitration panel, arbitration and conciliation act we have already done, it is a alternative dispute resolution mechanism where it's an out of court settlement where you sit across the table and discuss. And we have seen arbitration will not apply for criminal cases. I can't murder somebody and then say family compro will compromise, no, right? So that's the thing. Now the question is, what do you mean by this proceedings? Does it include all proceedings? Does it include all proceedings? 14A. Does it include all proceedings is the big question now, right? 14 1A. So basically friends, proceedings does not include all. Why? There is no bar on writ petitions given to whom? To the High Court and Supreme Court on question of law. When you have accepted the thing, admitted the application, NCLT has admitted the application, and I don't agree to your application, I don't agree that they have actually admitted, I have directly filed a writ. Correct? You would have mugged up, no, Indian constitution was there, no, for us in BCom. Correct? You had mugged up. Writ of habeas corpus, writ of certiorari. Have you done or not? Writ of mandamus. Correct? All those things. Full mugged up and gone. So that writ petition, if you are, you know, applying to the court on a question of law, you can't say High Court don't come here. That's why under this only, that friend that I was telling, na, he went and his dad went to the High Court, writ of, you know, this what writ here? This is the constitutional validity of moratorium. Can you say statute to that? No. Right? So writ petitions is definitely allowed. Next, criminal proceedings, guys, obviously no. Can I initiate criminal proceedings against the director, against the company? Can you say statute? No. Example, PMLA. Example. One more interesting case. What about An arbitral award. It is actually covered, you saw. Arbitral award prohibits, but I am gonna do a twist. Where the arbitral award, if it is awarded to the corporate debtor. What do you think? Those against or for? Here it is, the decision is for the corporate debtor. High court is telling you to pay 1 lakh statute. Surface is telling you to pay 1 crore statute. Arbitration is telling you will get 1 crore statute. No. Correct? So friends, if it is a benefit for the company, no tension. This was upheld in Power Grid versus Jyoti Structures. Power Grid Corporation versus Jyoti Structures, where an arbitral award was awarded to Jyoti Structures, which was undergoing CIRP. Power Grid versus Jyoti Structures. So the judge beautifully said, these, you should learn English from these judges, man, if not for anything. He said, moratorium is like an umbrella. Where you can ward off the storm. I read the judgments only to, for these dialogues. I get very excited to listen to these dialogues, to read these dialogues. Where you can ward off the storm, but harvest the rainwater. Brilliant. It's very simple. There's no, is there an insane English here? No. You use it as an umbrella to ward off the storm against you. But if some raindrops are coming and it is coming into you, benefit, please harvest it. Rainwater harvesting you do. Brilliant. These judges, hats off to them. Don't write this in the exam. It is an umbrella. Word of the storm. And they are asking section 14, are writing umbrella and all. Right? Don't write all this. Just for your knowledge, I'm saying. It's nice. The word of the storm, but harvest the rainwater. So if there is a benefit, gist of the story, if there's a benefit through a moratorium, then obviously there, I mean, if there's a benefit that you are getting, moratorium will not apply. Correct? No, moratorium will not apply, obviously. But if it's a detriment, if it's a detriment, then definitely moratorium will apply. But it will not apply to criminal detriment and also writ petition, which is the laid down in the foundations of the Indian Constitution. It is unconstitutional for you to tell statute for everything. So that delineation you need to understand. And guys, this is nothing but the maximization of value of assets. Where did you see this dialogue? Preamble, perfect. This is the exact meaning of this dialogue here. Maximization of value of assets. I am warding off the storm, but benefit coming, please come. Don't go away. That is the beauty of 14. Got it? Online friends, good morning. Are you here? Yes. The institution of suits or continuation of pending suits or proceedings against the corporate debtor, including execution of any judgment and also against, not for. And proceedings does not include all proceedings. What is it not covered? Writ petition and criminal. So any question they ask, it should strike us immediately. Next, transferring, encumbering, alienating or disposing of by the corporate debtor any of its assets or any legal right or beneficial interest therein. What do you mean by this? Transferring, cucumber, sorry, encumber, encumbering, then alienating or disposing. Transferring means what, guys? Simple. Where the ownership is transferred. Transfer of ownership from one person to another person is called transferring of assets. And of course, when you transfer the ownership, what you will get? Realization of money. So that will be prohibited. Assets I have to protect. Maximization of value of assets, I have to protect it. Encumbering means what? Yes, giving it as a security. I want some additional finance. I can take, IRB can take, but here company only has taken extra loan and given this right. So basically the company which is going through CIRP has taken loan from someone, money lender, bank, whatever it is, and has given this asset as a charge. Whereas this lender has become the charge holder. This is called encumbrance. Creating a charge, correct? Not possible. Cannot create a charge like that. When I say statue. Alienate means what? Alienate again is another form of transfer where asset will no longer belong to me. This director comes to know this is happening. So Aramse will give off as a gift one of the asset to, he'll approve a resolution, the board, where they'll gift themselves assets. Alienating can be treated as, you know, transferring without consideration also. It includes, alienate is to transfer without consideration. Example I'm giving. Alienating. Disposing of, to dispose of, generally disposing of is not OFF, we make a mistake while writing. Dispose of, it's not you are disposing it off, OFF, no, it is dispose of, OF, always. Even in CARO this word is there, no, disposal of, there don't write OFF, it is dispose OF. We had an argument with my boss, I remember. He was telling dispose off, OFF. I said, no sir, it's not off, it is off. So we had an argument, I still remember during my articleship days, that's why. So dispose off, what? It's the English, that's how it is. Don't ask rule and all, that's the way it is to be told, dispose off. So dispose off means what, guys? Where the location is changing. I'll aram say take away the assets, directors take away the assets and keep it off in their house. And they will write it off. Correct? Write off. All these things would be called as examples of dispose of. By the corporate debtor, any of its assets or any legal right or beneficial interest therein. If I am Furlenco and assume me as Furlenco, I am going through IBC. The assets are located elsewhere. All my assets are actually located elsewhere. But who has the ultimate title, beneficial interest? Me. Can I give that beneficial interest to somebody else? No. During the moratorium period? No. So that is the scene. It is not possible for us to do all these things. Any action to foreclose, recover or enforce any security interest created by the corporate debtor in respect of its property, including any action under Securitization and Reconstruction of Financial Assets and Enforcement of Security Interest Act, SARFAESI. So through SARFAESI, SARFAESI was one of the modes by the government where they decided. Just to give a gist of it, just to give a gist of the entire thing, I can show you that chart, which anyway is there in your chart book. It is under the SARFAESI thing, right? Quickly I'll show you, just to give you the concept of SARFAESI, that's all. So in SARFAESI, very simple guys, generally, there is a default, na? There is a default. Borrower is there. Banks would have given the loan guarantee. What would the banks have taken? Security of the financial assets, this one, this much. Security of the financial assets. They would have taken security of the financial assets. Surfaisi was a wonderful concept where they said, just like the concept of factoring, why don't I take over these financial assets? How will I take? Through establishment of a SCO or RCO, securitization company, reconstruction company. The securitization reconstruction company will take over these assets, will pay off this fellow either through cash or debentures. It's just the gist I'm telling you. Through cash or debentures, I'll pay off that bank or financial institution, no tension. Then it is my duty now to recover the money. Just like factoring. But with one added huge bonus or extra point which was not there elsewhere. SCO, RCO now can speak to the borrower. They can slightly take over the management of the borrower by appointing directors. They can ensure that extra money is given, right? They can try to revive the company. So if IBC is Bahubali part 2, Surfaisi was actually Bahubali the beginning. It had lot of problems though. What was the main problem? If you want this permission where I will take over the management or I will try to reconstruct your assets, your internal reconstruction that we did in merger and all that, whose permission is needed? The lenders. How much permission? 60%. I'm not talking about COC, even to actually go through this process. So that was a never ending process. And to even tell this, I showed you in the first part, almost 200 days used to get wasted. So that is why this was a failure. But still Surfaisi, it's going on. Many cases are going on through the Surfaisi route itself. So this, when I say that I want to take over your entire interest, take over your asset, that is called asset reconstruction and ESI, enforcement of security interest. Just the gist I told you. So that is what is given here. That can I do, means under Surfaisi, will I foreclose, will I recover, will I enforce the security interest under Surfaisi? No way. No way I am going to do this, allow you. The recovery of any property by an owner. The recovery of any property by a owner or lessor, it is actually, where such property is occupied by or in possession of the corporate debtor. What do you mean by this? Recovery of any property by an owner or lessor, where such property is occupied by or in possession of the corporate debtor. Yes, leased assets as well as property means what? Building. I am in this building owned by you. I have not paid you any money. You want to come and tell, please, I want to take away the property. You are about to enter only, outside I can stand statue. Correct? NCLT is telling office on rent, landlord cannot throw you out. Correct. Landlord cannot throw you out. Landlord, stand in the queue. Next question. Can landlord stand in the queue? We will connect it in section 18. Is landlord an operational creditor? You will go mad by that decision. Is landlord a financial creditor or operational creditor? Financial creditor, impossible, correct? No. Operational creditor, is it a service? There is a case law for that also. Is it a service? Is it goods? It's not goods. Space to utilize, is it a service? Is it a provision of service? There's a decision already. Right? You can't go to GST because in GST, you know, it's different. In GST, I think, if I'm not wrong, except land, everything else is a service. Correct, no? If I'm not wrong. Correct? Only land is a, except land, everything else is goods, something like that, it's there. Or everything else is service. Correct? So basically, that is different. Any non-movable things, correct? So that is how it is given there. Which means, yeah, correct. Except land, everything else is goods, which means land is a service. Yes, there. But there is a notification which says land is not a service. Tomorrow, if they tell land is a service, pay GST on that, you have to pay. All that is there that you leave. So if you see, what I am trying to tell is this thing. Actually, this is a good point. We can use it in the Jugalbandi series. We have created one Jugalbandi series where we talk about, I talk about law and Tarun Ratsa talks about GST. We can use this actually. Good point. What is service in Companies Act? What is goods under Companies Act and Sale of Goods Act? Vis-a-vis, what is the goods and service? That's an actual basic point only. We'll do that. Good. I realized now. Yes. So, if you see the recovery of any property. So, one question is this. Okay. I tell the landlord statute. But second, can the landlord join the queue? We will see it in section 18 later, not now. Right? So, this is the scene, guys. Recovery of any property by an owner or lessor where property is occupied by or in possession of the corporate debtor. Where the property is occupied by or in possession of the corporate debtor is the scene, is what we need to check. So, if you see, couple of cases, we'll check it out. I told you this section is very, very interesting. Important case, Supreme Court, Alchemist Asset Reconstruction versus Messrs Hotel Gowdavan Private Limited. Alchemist Asset Reconstruction. Institute has released a couple of weeks ago case laws on IBC. This is not for the exam, general book they have released. That also I'll share on the group. Or maybe somebody has already shared, I'm not sure. That also I'll share, you go through. That is like a collection of all case laws. It was a book that they have published, July 2020, they have published it very recently, 3 months ago. July, June, whenever, I don't know. Anyway, but it's recent. That is for general reading of chartered accountants, you go through. Institute does that only. Whatever is released from that only, they'll give. Pankaj Garg was an advocate, Shri Garg, all that. He said insolvency and stated that in the moratorium that is imposed, no arbitration proceedings can go on. This was against the proceedings point. So the thing is, section 14(1)(a) says continuation or pending or institution of proceedings. Proceedings will include arbitration also. Arbitration has been instituted. So finally, what they say, when arbitration has been instituted and when at the same time or even before that, when the moratorium is going on, arbitration proceedings will not go ahead. Arbitration will not go ahead. This went up to the Supreme Court because they thought arbitration proceedings, anyway it's going on, it cannot come under the concept of moratorium. So, it was based on a question of law, which again here, there were a couple of changes to this section also, 14(1)(a), before we spoke about all these things. Arbitration panel, it said. Correct? So, in that case, it went to arbitration slightly later. So, can it do? So, here anyway, the rule says institution of suits or continuation of pending suits. So, this was one of the earlier cases to go there, to the particular case. mandate of the new insolvency is that the moment an insolvency petition is admitted, moratorium comes into effect. Therefore, we set aside the order of the district judge. Unfortunately, the district judge had entertained the appeal and all those things in that case. They said, appeal, nothing will happen, boss. That is, we quashed the judgment, we quashed the proceeding. This was potentially an attempt to ensure that the IRP does not continue. So whatever the case, that will be, if you see, that steps taken under the insolvency code will continue unimpeded by any order of the court. I will not impede the proceedings. I will not stop the proceedings. I will not affect the proceedings in any way. It was one of the earlier judgments and it was in the nascent stages. What? The entire concept of insolvency. Now many cases are there, so it's easy for us. This was this case, October 23rd, 2017, quite old. But yeah, during that time, people were still unaware. Will arbitration come? Will this come? Suddenly, if you bring about a code which says everything else statute, people will have a doubt. That's why this thing had come. Anyway, though it was clearly written, but anyway, the judge clearly misread it maybe. Anyway, but Supreme Court has put the thing in place. This Jet Airways, I'll show you. Jet Airways landlord approaches NCLT to repossess the building. NCLT says, fetch you. But the question in Jet Airways, no, very peculiar. The lease rent period was over, not in existence, not in force rather. What to do? Will you be able to repossess when the lease rent period only is over? The owner of Siroya House, the building that houses the grounded Jet Airways headquarters, has approached the bankruptcy court seeking a direction to the custodian of the airline assets to vacate the premises. The lease agreement for the building terminated on June 7th, and company was admitted for debt resolution on June 20th. But goods including computers, files of that are still lying in the office. Lucky Star Property Holdings told the Mumbai bench of the NCLT. The resolution professional has no power to possess the property which is owned by someone else and not by the corporate debtor. Senior counsel Janak Dwarkadas argued, the law is clear. The possession of property belongs to a licensor and the licensee has only juridical possession till the time which is mentioned in an agreement, he said. The airline has not paid rent. If the RP had any doubt about the possession of the property, he could have come to the tribunal to seek clarity, but he has so, and hence they are seeking tribunal's intervention to direct the RP to pay for these months. What do you think? The Mumbai has admitted the insolvency petition filed by SBI, guys. SBI, always. So if you see, that's the thing. Now there are so many questions that come. First of all, rent, can I repossess the building? Second of all, this rent which is there till here, which day? Till the admission day. Can I recover? Second, if the rent is still, I mean, if he's still possessing the building, should I claim the rent? Correct? Should I claim the rent? So, would this come under claims, this part? In the claim, submission of claims, will it come there? Submission of claims. And here, will this be part of the entire insolvency process costs? All these discussions are there, they will give also in the exam, which we have to do later when we do section 18. Section 18 is what, friends? What is section 18? I'm telling you from that time, section 18, we have not seen only what is section 18. Duties of the what? Interim resolution professional. So I cannot just do this without connecting 18. We will see that later. That's a different discussion. Duties of the interim resolution professional is a different discussion altogether. Later. Can he repossess the building? Can he take the possession of the building? All that we have to see later. Got it? This we need to hold on. Next. All this done. Recovery of any property done. Now, this is one part of it. In a case, Embassy Property Developers versus, you know, Embassy Golf Link, Embassy I've seen everywhere in Karnataka versus State of Karnataka. These Embassy Property Developers were also into mining and other things as well. So the thing here was, there was a mining lease was going on. Will the mining lease under the contract was supposed to be extended? So Embassy Property had the mining lease. It was supposed to be extended. So moratorium is on the extension of the lease, or moratorium is for holding the lease, was the question. Under the agreement, it was supposed to be extended, but then they said, I will not extend it. Embassy Property said, boss, moratorium will not affect any extension or anything, business can continue. The Supreme Court had the opinion that the extension of the mining lease is not allowed. When I say statute, what I actually mean is, it means that you can still hold the lease. You have a right not to be, you know, dispossessed. Means you have a right not to be thrown out, but extension and all will not be granted. Then Embassy Property said, sir, how will we do business? Valid question. When the mining lease only is not extended, how will I do business? Supreme Court said, I don't care. The moratorium is just that, hold the lease. Extension we'll see later. Lease you can hold. This, they said, sir, if that is the case, then what to do? We will not be able to do business and all those things. That was the thing. So friends, very, very important amendment where this Supreme Court decision has been overthrown. Lot of analysis goes into doing these classes and I love doing it. Really, it excites me. I study for 10 hours just to do all these things, because it's, you will not find this anywhere. I'm not joking. To sit and search, research. I have some 10 subscriptions. Yesterday also I bought one subscription, because you need to connect so many things, right? So SC overthrew the judgment. Two amendments came, guys. When did it come? 28/12/2019, which means first time ever it can come in the coming examinations. 114 subsection 1 explanation was added, and one more 14(3)(a) came. Let's read 14 subsection 1 explanation, because to overthrow the judgment in Embassy. See, explanation. For the purposes of this subsection, 6D people, write it down there, the case law. For the purpose of this subsection, it is hereby clarified that notwithstanding anything contained in any other law for the time being in force, it was against that Mining Act or something, one more act was there, it was against that. There it said extension all cannot be granted. Here I am saying notwithstanding anything contained, non-obstant clause, this will override that, because it's a conflict. A license, permit, registration, quota, concession, clearance, or a similar grant or right given by the central government, state government, local authority, sectoral regulator like IRDA, you have a license to run broking houses, you have a license to run insurance companies, whatever it is, or any other authority constituted under any law for the time being in force, shall not be suspended or terminated on the grounds of insolvency. subject to the condition that there is no default in payment of the current dues arising for the use or continuation of the license, permit, registration, quota, concession, clearance or a similar grant or right during the moratorium period. Deadly. What do they say? First, Aram say use it, but ensure at least the mining license fee you have paid. License fee you are not paying, now you want to continue. That is unfair. Correct? No default in payment of current dues arising for the use of or continuation of license, permit, registration, quota and all these things. Then they said this may be misused then. If I tell any license, any quota, and the government regulate which company, which sector they will give this permission? Yes, that is 14(3)(a). Yes, continuation will obviously cover extension now. That's why this was to overthrow the judgment of which one? Supreme Court in the case of embassy property. The provisions of subsection 1 shall not apply to such transactions, such agreements or other arrangements as may be notified by the central government in consultation with any financial sector regulator or any other authority. So who can tell that, guys? Government. Government can fix the plan. Government can say it will apply to only this, it will not apply to this, it will apply to this, like that. They can say this section will apply to this, this section, subsection will not apply. So these two were inserted when? 28-12-2019 for the as against this judgment. Done. Now let's take our company only, Advait Learning Private Limited. We are using BESCOM electricity supply. We are using, no problem. Do we need electricity to run the business here? Obviously. Is it an essential service? Yes. Or let me say I am a printing press. Here somebody has applied for insolvency. I have not paid this 2 months electricity bill also. They have given me a warning. Now I am going through insolvency. Question number one. Can BESCOM stand as operating creditor, operational creditor? This there is no problem, not like landlord, 100% service, correct? Okay, yes you can. Question number two, can they cut electricity? Here, I haven't paid, no. CIRP has begun. Can they cut electricity? What do you think? Can they cut electricity? You can be operational creditor, okay. This period now, CIRP, can I cut electricity? If you say no, you can't cut electricity, then this amount here, whatever it is, this will be my entire CIRP cost of running the business. Can I commit default here also? I'll not pay, you do whatever you want. So basically that fellow 2-3 months also not paid, then now also not paid, and it's running into lakhs, printing press I'm running. 14(2)(a). Supply of essential goods or services. So the corporate debtor as may be specified, shall not be terminated or suspended or interrupted during moratorium period. Question number one is very simple. Can I come in there? Yes. Can I come as an operational creditor? Yes. Question number two. Can I cut electricity? No. Regulation 32 of that same regulation. Essential goods and services referred to in 14.2 shall mean electricity, water, telecommunication services and information technology services. Airtel broadband can be considered as telecom, right? Services, information technology, all IT related services, all your computers and all that stuff. To the extent that these are not a direct input to the output produced or supplied by the corporate debtor. Means what? What about water? What water is this? Normal, you know, water for, you know, drinking, water for the loo. Is this water for hydro, you know, the hydro project? That is what, to the extent that these are not a direct input to the output. Water supply to a corporate debtor will be essential supplies for drinking and sanitation and not for generation of hydroelectricity. You will take one bucket of water and put on the turbine? No. It requires incredible force. Correct? That is what they said. I am a printing press, I told you. I have not paid for the dye, for the, you know, printer. I have not yet paid for the ink. What about that? Is that essential service? Is that essential service? As far as what is essential service or not, under 14.2A, two conflicting judgments are there, friends. ICICI Bank Limited versus Innovative Industries. Important case law, Institute has given already. ICICI Bank versus Innovative. One more, Canara Bank versus Deccan Chronicle Holding. Deccan Chronicle Holding, you know, Deccan Chronicle newspaper was there. Where is it there now? That's all. IRP. IRP is going on. Here they say whatever regulation 32 says, that only, because they have used the word means. Means means what? Exhaustive. But opposite judgment, here they have told it is exhaustive. It was exhaustive. Means they are saying, boss, whatever is needed for the furtherance of business, you are telling during moratorium period you do the business. How will I do the business? Ink is not there. Dye is not there. What business I'll do? Hold on, Sachin, I will answer all those queries. Stick to this now. That is a different section, whatever you are asking. Right? So what do I do? So, is there a need to extend the meaning of this entire concept? Can I make it extend? Should I extend the meaning of this? Was the question. This was also supported by two, three other cases. One is Dakshin Gujarat, which company limited. versus ABG Shipyard. And also again this Innovative again came. Innovative versus Maharashtra State Electricity Board. So many interconnections come in 18, we haven't even done it. In all these cases, it was only with respect to payment of dues arising from the supply of services. From the supply of services. Right? So, Sachin here was asking, I have to pay for essential services and also clear the previous dues, or should I only pay for moratorium dues? Because of which, friends, what came? Amendment. When? 28/12/2019. All this can come now. This anyway would not have been applicable for May 20 also. The objective of IBC is the continuation of business. Figure out. Where the interim resolution professional or the resolution professional, as the case may be, considers the supply of goods or services critical to protect and preserve the value of the corporate debtor and manages the operations of such corporate debtor as a going concern, then the supply of such goods or services shall not be terminated, suspended or interrupted during the period of such moratorium, except where, Sachin, your answer, this should be linked with 18 also later, where such corporate debtor has not paid dues arising from such supply during the moratorium period. In such circumstances as may be prescribed. Did you get it? What are they saying? BESCOM, you can stand as operational creditor, no problem. You can stand as an operational creditor. How many months not paid? 3 months not paid. Now I am coming to cut statute. You pay my bill, I will not pay. You do whatever you want. You please give electricity. At least during 180-90 will you pay? Yes, I will pay. Then if you not pay, will I cut electricity? Yes. Are you getting my point? During this 180 plus 90 days, will you pay for the electricity that you are using? Yes, I will. If you don't, then can I cut? Yes, that is what it means. Shall not be terminated, suspended or interrupted during the period of moratorium. Except, when will it be terminated? Where the corporate debtor has not paid dues arising from such supply during the moratorium period. During the moratorium period. So, BESCOM, 3 months I have not paid, I will not pay. Do whatever you want. Don't cut. 2 and 2A is there. It is needed for my business. Ink I have not paid, Deccan Chronicle. Give, supply. I will not pay also for previous one. Stand there as operational creditor. But now for die and ink, should I pay? Yes. If I don't do business, how will I revive? How will other companies come and take over? Brilliant provision. Are you getting it, guys? So this is what? 14 2A. Correct. Normal purchase and all will continue. One more you see, guys. 240 to 1A. This was essential goods and services shall not be interrupted or suspended during moratorium period. But here they have say supply of goods critical to protect. But basically you cannot, basically this both applies to the same essential good. What they are trying to tell is IRP has the right to decide what are essential services. And as simple as that, you need to pay for it during the period. Before that, it will be forming part of the claims. Before that, it will be forming part of the claims. Right? So, BESCOM, whatever it is, during the period, you kindly pay. There are many judgments supporting this claim also. And then you see, guys, I told you which one? 240. 240 subsection 2. One connection point I'll show you. Power to make regulations. The board IBBI may by notification make regulations consistent with this code and rules made thereunder to carry out the provisions of this code. Code and rules, who will make the rules? CG. Regulation will make IBBI. And in two, in particular and without prejudice to the generality of the foregoing, where did we discuss this? 182 of Companies Act. Without prejudice to the generality of the foregoing means what? This is a general point, but whatever I am giving here is the example. This is a general point, but whatever I am giving here is an example. In that CIA, they should see such regulations may provide for what? Circumstances in which supply of critical goods or services may be terminated, suspended or interrupted during the period of moratorium under 2A of section 14. 2A of section 14. Correct. Yes or no? Circumstances. So they will give regulations as to circumstances where I can say that the supply of goods etc. may be terminated and all those things. So essential supplies is given here, guys, already. Essential supplies is given in regulation 32. They can add more and more regulations where they say when it will be suspended. And mind you, it can either be this or that. If you don't pay during the period of this thing. So basically now BESCOM and all those things, what they are trying to tell, at the initiation of CIRP, this will come under the claims. Whereas after this, this has to be paid. If it is not paid, cut it. Or circumstances which under this 240-21A, government only will, not government, IBBI will tell what could be the circumstances under which it can be suspended or interrupted. But this question still remains, friends. What about the landlord? For that, I have to section 18, I have to see. Landlord, can he ever be called as an operational creditor? Correct? Brilliant section, man, this is. Section 14, amazing. Still not over, story. It will go into tomorrow also, guarantee. Not at all. Even this is missing. Now, we haven't even done this. Which one? But the property? Property is what we need to see. Correct. That's the thing. So, if you see, a very, very interesting case, guys, is the Walnut. This is given in the institute also. So we'll see. And this 14 too will go. This was where Asset Tree Construction Company versus Venkata Krishnan. And ANR means another. So same thing happened here. Two CIRP were initiated, one against Paragon Private Limited, other against SMM, which had common resolution professional, and matters were heard together. Two units were there, the office was at the same location, Kerala Electricity Board. Isn't it wrong to bind the service providers? Because it's an essential service, that's why it is not wrong to bind them. Since it's an essential service, the objective of IBC only is different, is for revival. And electricity, whether we like it or not, is an essential service, water and electricity. But now that illustration is there, which is in section 32, what is that? Water for the turbine. Don't you think so? That is needed to do the going concern. Yes, so that also is covered under 2A. I hope you know that. In that regulation, turbine, water, that is most essential to run it as a going concern. So under 2A, can I force? Yes. This will be in an subject of lot of litigation. Litigation was about to start when Corona came. Now it is all, and Corona says statue to IBC, that's the best part. 1 year statue. Nothing can be done now. Correct? So that is the thing. Big Daddy. Here they are telling statue, statue. On top, Corona said statue. So if you see, it's the same thing happened here, guys. Electricity board. See the due. 3.25 crores. Which is equivalent to the dues payable to, for the months falling within the CIRP process. Forget about the previous thing. During that 3.25 crores was 180 plus 90 days. Put it in a different escrow account. He actually deposited that also, no problem. Correct? But what they did, they adjusted towards the payments payable during the CIRP process, that's okay. The operational criteria also, Kerala State Electricity Board was all, you know, operational criteria also. That payment 3.25 crores, Kerala, what did they do? They adjusted against the earlier period also. Can they do it? Means what? CIRP began now, na? This was 3.25 crores. This assume was some 1 crore. So, Kerala Electricity Board was an operational creditor also. When I am depositing 3.25 crore, it should only be for this. You cannot adjust this amount. What did the Kerala State Electricity Board do? Adjust it. So, these fellows went to the court. Correct? So, clearly, here also they told the same thing. The escrow account, first of all, came into force only because CIRP has begun. How can you adjust it to the previous account? So, the gist of the story was very simple. You cannot adjust it to the old account. Cannot adjust. They have given the essential service, all that they have given. So, it was not open. Then they disconnected the electricity. So, they say, see, it was not open to electricity board to disconnect the electricity, which is in violation of 14.2. It had no jurisdiction to disconnect the electricity. And of course, they are an operational creditor as defined in 520 and 521. And they also went to the other thing, that is Uttarakhand Power Corporation versus ANG Industries here. Uttarakhand Power Corporation, ANG Industries also, same decision had been taken there also. Amount payable towards the current charges during the CIRP was definitely payable to Uttarakhand Power Corporation Limited. In the view of the aforesaid, we hold that it is not open to the electricity board to disconnect the electric supply. Resolution professional should not have paid any dues of the earlier period for restoration. Should have brought back to the AA. Kerala fellow said, the electricity board, if you don't pay the previous thing, I will not. Normal they do, no? Sir, clear the dues only then. This fellow paid off 3.25 crores. In that, it was adjusted against the previous one. They said, boss, when you are giving the claims, you have to stand in the line. Operational creditor, you can't even come to the COC. Now I am giving you the payment, which is overriding financial creditors. That can never happen. Brilliant decision. Correct, this and the Uttarakhand power corporation as ANG, similar judgment here also. So here they say kindly pay the installment during the CIRP. Everywhere they are telling the same thing. So if you are getting the payment, why not? You can supply, right? For the old payments, you can do what? You can stand in the queue. That is the scene. Deadly case. Deadly case. These three people passed this. Important case, Messrs. Walnut Packaging Private Limited. All these institute has given in the case law thing, which is there in paper 6D also. Paper 4, they have not launched it. But still, you know, you can study that. Institute only has given the compendium of important cases. Two times they have released, one before, one recently also. All this is there in that. Walnut Packaging Private Limited case. What was the decision, guys? Lease rent dues of an immovable property, not operational debt under IBC. The tenancy was yearly in nature and it was up to 85,67,290 rupees. Correct. Here enhanced rent is what they asked for. Every contract will have an enhancement, right? 5%, 10%. That rent was coming up to almost, the default was 30,15,370. The corporator contended that it had paid rent until December 2017 and no amount was due. Because of the slowdown in operations, etc., it was agreed that there would be a moratorium for no yearly enhancement rent for 6 years. They agreed also that there will be no enhancement. Since there was no documentary proof for acceptance of moratorium, NCLT concluded that corporator failed in making the payment of rents and admitted the insolvency. Who was the operational creditor there? Landlord. After hearing the party, NCLT observed the corporator had been regular in paying the rent in terms of the lease deed, even with an increase of 10% increase per annum. It further noted that the original lease period expired in 2006, after which 11 to 17 is a disputed period. There was no agreement for enhancement of rent as such. Had they paid the rent properly? Yes. What didn't they pay? Enhancement. For the enhancement, who sued? Landlord. How much was that? Some 30 lakhs or something. The NCLAT thus proceeded to answer if the debt claims on amount account of unpaid could actually qualify as a debt under IBC. And they relied on other judgment. Operational word only has not been defined, no? See how they have to go. Operational word is not defined. Operation also has not been defined. Neither in IBC nor in the General Clauses Act. So they only defined. They said of or relating to operation or ready for use or able to be used. That is the meaning of operation. Provision of goods, provision of services, debt arising under any statute and payable to government or local authority. That is there in the definition. So they say if the claim by way of debt does not fall under any of the three categories as mentioned above, that is what? Provision of goods, provision of services including employment and debt arising under any statute. This is the definition of what? Operational creditor. Operational debt. Operational debt. The claim cannot be categorized as an operational debt even though there may be a liability. Brilliant decision. What is a debt? Obligation. But the debt has to be operational, means what? Where you have worked on it, means what? Have you given goods? Have you provided the service as such is the question. So legislature did not include the reference of rent dues of property. This petition has filed for recovery of enhanced rent. This is not about goods or services in respect of goods or services. They told, okay, even if I agree that you have given the house on rent, building on rent, okay, I agree that is a service. Enhanced rent, what extra service you have given? Are you getting the point, guys? Correct? hence what they said, it will not be, we are of the considered opinion that lease of immovable property cannot be considered as a supply of goods or rendering of any services. Yes guys, can you see me? Some minor problem. Right, cannot be what? Cannot be what? Considered as goods or supply of services. Cannot be goods or supply of services. And it cannot fall within the definition of operational debt. Cannot fall within the definition of operational debt. This is what they said. In view of the above, it was dismissed. So this is the scene, guys. This was the final case. Now we still have to discuss this 14(3)(b). We'll discuss it tomorrow, but I'm just giving you what is the thing this pending. This what is the surety of contract and all, and also in this 3D has to be linked with section 18. 3D has to be linked with section 18. All that we will do it tomorrow. Did you guys understand? Still not over. Correct? So many things are there in this particular law. 14 has to be linked with 18 also. Right? Okay, guys. See you tomorrow. Okay. Rent dues are what then? Rent dues are operational credit are only. But enhanced rent. What? Enhanced rent. You have not, have you given any extra service? No. But in that particular case, they said it will not come also as service. It will not come as service. A provision of service should be any operation that you have done, where you have actually provided something. Just providing immovable property is not a service, is what that case said. That particular case said it is neither goods nor services. So you have no claim as a financial creditor or operational creditor. Walnut packaging. Clear? On that note, we shall end today's class. See you tomorrow, guys. We have to do the other things. Okay?